My name is Rolf Künecke. I'm professor of economics of infrastructures at Delft University of Technology. In this lecture, I would like to tell you something about institutions. When analyzing and considering responsible innovation, it is very important to be aware of the rules and regulations under which these responsible innovations are developed or introduced. In literature, these rules are often referred to as institutions. To start with, I would like to give you a definition of what institutions are often referred to in literature. Of course, there are a lot of different definitions, and I find this definition of Jeff Hodgson from 2006 very important and interesting. He defines institutions as systems of established and embedded social rules that structure social interactions. So essentially, institutions are social rules. And these social rules can be either established or embedded, and they are needed to structure these interactions. And I would like to illustrate this definition with a short example. And this example is offshore wind energy, which can be considered as an innovation of the electricity system. Here we see a small map of the Dutch part of the North Sea, and as illustrated by these different lines and dots, this North Sea is not an empty space, but it is used for very different purposes, like for instance, natural recreation or naval transport, fishery, cables, or even military uses. Military areas are there to practice certain military maneuvers. And in addition, wind energy is introduced into the North Sea. So the North Sea is not an empty space, but there are very different users that make use of the North Sea. And these users, of course, need to adhere to certain social rules. It would not be useful to have military exercise areas very close to naval transport routes or to wind power areas. So we need to dedicate certain areas for certain purposes in order to make it possible that all these different users can make use of the North Sea. In other words, we need social rules how to use this space for different purposes. So coming back to this definition, we need social rules in order to structure these social interaction between the different users of the North Sea. These different rules can be either established or embedded. What does that mean? If we want to use the North Sea for the production of wind power, we need to dedicate certain areas of the North Sea to the production of wind power. If we want to use the North Sea for military purposes, we need to assign certain areas very precisely where the military may take their exercises. So we need certain formal rules to dedicate these areas for specific purposes. But there might also be what is called in this definition embedded social rules. So going back to the example of offshore wind, fishers might have a long tradition of generations that they use certain areas of the North Sea for fishing for herring or other fishes. There might be certain rules or informal rules that certain areas are used for recreational purposes. And these social rules are not based on formal regulation, they are embedded. They are based on certain traditions that people did for long periods of time. So these social rules might be either established by formal rules and regulations, but they might also be embedded by certain traditions or norms that evolved during centuries. The third aspect, which is important in this definition, is that institutions are constituted by systems of social rules. And going back to my example of offshore wind, if we want to install offshore wind turbines in the North Sea, we might alter the existing rules, which are in favor of naval transport or fishery, and we need to allocate certain areas for the use of wind power. But it's not only allocating a specific area for wind power, the other users will be impeded by these new rules of wind power in the North Sea. And we need to be aware how these other users are impeded by these new rules. So if we dedicate certain areas for wind power. Fishers are not allowed to use these area anymore. Naval transport need to choose these other routes. And military exercises, of course, might also be prohibited close to this area. So we are not talking about single rules, but we are looking at a system of different social rules. So these are the important elements of this definition. Going a step further, it might be very interesting to find out whether there are specific categories of institutions that are worthwhile to be aware of. And these categories of institutions are identified by Oliver Williamson in an important article of 1989. He identified four different layers of institutions, which are illustrated here in this graph. Let's start with the upper layer, L1, which he called the embeddedness. These are typically informal institutions, customs, traditions, norms, and religions, to which I also referred to in my earlier example. So fishers might be used to use certain areas for fishing, military might be used for a long period of time to use certain areas in the sea for their exercises. Without having specific rules and regulations that formally substantiate these rights. So this is called embeddedness. And the frequency of change of these informal rules is typically very low. So Williamson uses an indication of once in 100 or 1,000 years. So this is really deeply embedded in the behavior of people or actors. The purpose, which is a third category which Williamson identifies in this scheme, is often non-calculative. These informal rules just evolve very spontaneously, and they are very difficult to plan. So trying to influence these informal rules, these embedded rules, is quite a difficult task. But it is this layer one which is very important if we look to responsible innovation. I will come back to this shortly. The second layer is the institutional environment. These are the formal rules of the game. So the constitution of states, or if we look to the offshore wind case again, the energy or electricity law on which the establishment of the wind farms, offshore wind farms, is based. So these formal rules, general rules, define the rules of the game. And the frequency of change here is about once in 10 or 100 years. So these formal rules are still quite stable. But here we can identify a specific objective. So the objective from an economic point of view might be getting the institutional environment right. And Williamson refers to this as first order economizing. So which institutions would serve best a purpose of stimulating the development of clean offshore wind energy might be one of the conditions under which we might design specific formal rules for the establishment of offshore wind power in the example, as I just mentioned. The third layer is the layer of governance, the play of the game. Given the formal rules, given the embeddedness, the informal institutions, what kind of contracts or legal organizational forms can firms choose or other actors choose to get the governance right, to realize their objectives? So this is what Williamson calls second-order economizing, which contracts, which organizations serve best certain individual objective of firms or actors. And these governance structures indicatively change once in 1 or 10 years, so the frequency of change is much higher here, much shorter here than in the upper layers. Finally, the fourth layer is indicated by a continuous change of rules and regulations, so resource allocation and employment, the daily routines to get the marginal conditions right, and this is referred to as third-order economizing. So these are the four different layers or categories of institutions that we can identify. A very interesting aspect of these different layers is indicated in this scheme by the arrows, top-down and bottom-up arrows. So these different layers are not to be analyzed in isolation. If there are certain norms or customs, certain informal institutions in a country or in a region, it is important that these rules and informal institutions are taken care of by the institutional environment. So the formal rules of the game are to a certain degree based on the informal institutions. And if this would not be the case, we would have a serious problem, because these formal institutions would not be credible. So we need to align the informal institutions to the formal rules. And if we go further down in this layered scheme, we can also argue that the governance and the resource allocation need also to be aligned with each other. So these different layers of institutions are structured by a certain logic. These different layers need to be built up in a specific way by each other, and otherwise we would have disturbances. But there's also a dotted arrow bottom up. So it might be that resource allocation or governance changes, and this might have influence on the formal rules and even on the informal institutions. And going back to the example of the energy sector, in the energy sector at the moment, we see that there is a lot of attention for decentral energy production and consumption, even at a household level. Solar panels on the roofs of people are not only used for these individual households, but surpluses are also fed into the grid. We see, we might consider these initiatives on a local level as a change in the governance of the energy sector. This change of the governance requires that the institutional environment is also adapted to this new practice of producing and using energy, which would be indicated by the arrow bottom up. And this might also have influences on the informal institutions. Households might consider that the production of electricity is not anymore an issue which the state should provide, but which is something they could take care of by themselves. And that would indicate a change of the informal institutions or the values that are associated to the production and use of energy. So this interrelation between these different layers of institutions is very important if we consider responsible innovation. It's not only a top-down activity, but as I illustrated also with the example of decentralized electricity production, there is also a bottom-up development from the individual users towards change of the governance, towards change of the institutional environment, and the embedded institutions and the values of customs. In this respect, I think it is very important to consider these different categories of institutions when analyzing responsible innovation. Thank you.